but more importantly, was on display with me as they received me at the winery. I mean, I couldn't tell you how many times we talked about our neighbors and how important they are in the history and development of Charles. For instance, Henriot, Joseph Henriot was one of the initial investors in Charles Heidsieck. He actually loaned money to Charles himself to start his own winery. And I mean, we pay a lot of tribute to our neighbors, and without them, we wouldn't be, you know, where we are, and the region itself wouldn't be where it is. So I got much love for our neighbors and for all the wines that come out of the region. At the end of the day, like I said, we're stronger together than we are apart. And I'm proud to, you know, have an open invite to everybody that wants to come to the party. There's no way that you can't have a Charlie party without our neighbors. Yeah. Come on, let's go.
Well, I just wanted to mention that, you know, when you had we offline on FaceTime, you showed me how to properly open a bottle of champagne. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I was terrified. I thought I was going to pop the cork and it was going to break my windows or something. And you showed me, it took, you know, it only took like, what, about 8 minutes, like 5 minutes? I can't remember how long. It seemed like forever to me. I was terrified.
Yeah, it was, I mean, if I look back to the call, I think it was like 3 minutes. You did it an incredible amount of time. It was so swift and elegant.
It really felt like really forever. But thank you so much. But, you know, I had great direction. So I wanted to talk about that procedure and, well, those directions that you gave me and just some of those tips that you have for stuff like that, you know, opening a bottle, the right glass, the right stemware, that type of thing. Because it was like, I'm used to people like opening a bottle and it's just like, psh, you know, champagne flowing. It was a test.
Yes.
Talk
so the most important thing is the first step is to keep your bottle at 45 degree angle. And this is to relieve the pressure when the cork comes out. So when you keep that, if you're right-handed or left-handed, as we talked about, take your dominant hand, you're going to put it around the cork, and the tip of the bottle, essentially. And you're going to keep your thumb on it at all times, because we know that once you have this pressure, the cork can go anywhere. It's like you said, it could be dangerous. You take your less dominant hand and you put it on the base of the bottle. And basically what you're going to do is you're going to remove the cork from the bottle by holding onto the cork and then twisting the bottle only. And of course, this is after you've removed the cage, loosened the cage. So what we're going to do here is you just unwind the cage and you choke up and loosen it to make it nice and wide like this. And I'm showing this to you because I've already removed the cork, but essentially this would be done like so. You remove it, you're holding the cork, and then you take it away, and you'll get really used to it. And so I'm going to challenge you to open 6 more bottles of champagne this summer, okay? And I guarantee you, by the 3rd bottle, you're going to be a professional. Absolutely. You're going to hear no sound. You're going to be pushing back on the cork perfectly. You're going to get to that moment where you know the cork is almost there, and you can just twist it off elegantly, and next thing you know, it's – you know, the angels are singing and the cherubs and voila, and then it's go time and let's go, you know? So,
that's
you know,
exactly how it was. And what, and you know, they're going to be 6 bottles of yours because you told me exactly where to look, you know, at the top of the head. So it's going to be 6 bottles of yours, of your champagne.
I appreciate that, but I would also encourage you to try a few others because honestly, you'll get a chance to learn what you like about champagne, and more importantly, what you like about Charles.
Okay. Do you have rosé? Do you have sparkling rosé?
We do. We sure do. We do make a rosé. I'll show you a few bottles that we make. So our rosé champagne is like this. You can find this and our Brut Reserve, which is our flagship here at Binny's. There's a few other wine shops that we are very proud to partner with. For instance, Knightsbridge up north. They will deliver to your door, and they carry a wide range of our wines. We're really proud to partner with them. But our rosé is very similar in style to the Brut that we're drinking right now. However, what we do is we add a little bit of red wine during the bottling process to give you that expression and decadence that we expect out of a rosé champagne. So it's a really pretty wine. The other one that I would also like to note is our vintage. Our vintage comes in a gold label like this. This is the 2006. Again, you can find this at Knightsbridge online, knightsbridge.com. They will deliver to your door. And then last but not least is our Dark Night of Champagne. This is the Blanc de Millenaire. This is a 100% Chardonnay-based vintage champagne. So there is a vintage on here. This is the 2004, our current vintage. And it's 100% Chardonnay, so we call it Blanc. So Blanc de Blanc is the term for a champagne based on white grapes only, which we use Chardonnay. And this is in our cellar for a minimum of 11 years before we released it. So an incredible harmony of age and time to show you the precision of the type of wines that we make. But again, our flagship wine, the one that you're having right now, in my opinion, is pound for pound. We kill it. And we love to disrupt. And more importantly, we couldn't do it without the quality that goes in this bottle. This is the most important wine that we make at the winery. It's a large percentage of our production. So I would say about 70 to 80% of our production is this bottling, because this is the first step that people will usually experience from Charles. And more importantly, it takes, like I said, many years of aged wines to create this style of winemaking. So we're making an individual wine many, many times, so like 200 individual wines. So then we watch how they develop over the time, and then we choose to blend them when they're ready with a base vintage. So it's an incredible, magical mystery tour that, honestly, I'm so proud of our Chef de Cave and the Chef de Caves we had in the past to get us to this point. Because without their work, we would never be able to make a wine like this. And a lot of times people forget is that when you're a chef de cave in Champagne of a house like Charles, you know, you have to keep all of this together. It's like, could you imagine making 20 different dishes on a stove at the same time and remembering where each dish is throughout the moment? I mean, that's literally, that's why we call them chef de cave. I mean, it's incredible to see that they manage all these flavors, and at the same time, they create this harmony on your palate, you know, just like a chef would on his dish. So it's very, very interesting and very intriguing. And more importantly, I saw it firsthand, and wow, it's like watching a master at work, which really is the truth. So the Champagne winemakers are of a very different breed than most winemakers. And if anyone wants to refute that, come to Champagne and we'll show you how it's done. And you can try, but trust me, good luck.
Why did you tell me to put down my flute and pick up a wine glass?
Ah, yes. So the flute is a beautiful, elegant looking a piece of glass that I think is best suited as a paperweight. So,
okay.
Let's go. So the flute is great. I mean, it's really elegant, and I love the way it looks. And trust me, you know, I don't mind drinking out of a flute, but I know the effort and work that goes into our wine. When I mentioned, you know, 2 decades of time and aging, you want to smell that. Not 90% of what you're tasting is what we smell. And in a flute, you're not going to be able to get it. So I really encourage people to take any champagne, frankly, because the rules of the region of Champagne, they have to be aged for many years. And that's by law. So for us, we're overachievers and we go a little bit further. But with our wine, you really want to use a white wine glass, a red wine glass, or I get aggressive and I go with the burgundy glass because I love the way that this wine smells. Burgundy. I think for me, it's so natural to want to put my nose in here. And I almost want to smell it more than drink it. And that's the beauty of it. So if you put it in a flute, you would never get that experience. So you're honestly stripping yourself. It's like saying, oh, I bought a Ferrari, but I'm going to put it on a donut. You know, let's put donuts. You know, you got this beautiful car.
What am I smelling in here, though?
No, you're smelling success over there. That's what you're smelling. That's what it is. But really, it's the age. So the age is what you initially will get. It's the mouth.